Good afternoon. Welcome to this lecture. My name is Michael Benson. I'm the co-director of Virtual London, my partner, Professor Farshad. I'm childishly happy to be able to introduce two people for whom I have the most immense respect. First of all, on my left, Leah Johnson, a great friend and a collaborator, together with one or two other people, one of which just left the room, Francis Hodgson, put together the pre-kit tape, and Sebastião Salgado, who was one of perhaps the most important guiding light when we began thinking about the pre-kit tape. It was a great honour for us a couple of days ago to present Sebastião with the first Photo London Master of Photography. I think what we're going to find out now is exactly why we did that. So I'm going to hand over to Leo and Sebastião, and I hope you have a great, very good time.
Thank you, and congratulations to all of you who made it up these stairs. The only person who was not out of breath was him. Okay. So there's a story when someone was trying to introduce Henry Kissinger, and he started to introduce Kissinger by saying, "The following speaker, of course, needs no introduction," at which point Kissinger tapped him on the arm and said, "I do not need an introduction, but I would like an introduction." Okay. Sebastião Salgado does not need an introduction, and he does not want an introduction, so I'm not going to give him a long introduction. We know he's won all the awards you could care to mention. You know, he most recently won the Photo London Master of Photography Award. He's a guy who Jonathan James of The Guardian has called the last great photographer. I want to start, Sebastião, by going right to the heart of things. And we're going to go on a journey, and in a little bit, we're going to have the privilege of Sebastião showing us some of his work. I want to sort of go through a bit of the journey. I want to start right at the beginning with one of the many stupendous things about your life, which is that you had seven sisters.
And seven Marias. All Marias.
Your sisters were all called Maria.
Maria. Maria Teresa, Maria da Penha, Maria de Lourdes, but all Marias.
What effect did this have on you? What was it like growing up in Minas Gerais with your seven Marias? What was it like?
No, it was much more than seven Marias, because I have, of course, my mother, my grandmother, two cousins. In the end, there were about 13 ladies.
All called Maria.
Marias are all my sisters, but 13 women as I grow between them, my father. And once a year, I have an uncle of my father, come to our home for 2-3 months, but was fabulous, amazing, and what is very good, because made me have another position in the life. I'm 100% sure if the world was directed by the ladies, not by the men, I'm 100% sure, for example, the ground of the streets, the road would be not black. Probably they'll be red, they'll be pink. It's so ugly, red, and probably be other color. And many things would be different. And this I learned real inside my home with my...
Like in Salvador. Can you tell us, we'll get on, we'll get on. I want to pick up on this issue of the masculine and the feminine, maybe a little bit later. Can we go back to some of the big turning points in your life? Tell us about the moment where, as you described it, photography did this invasion of your life.
You see, Leo, I have many important points in my life. Many. But one of the most important is when I discovered my mother. This point was so important for me. Was in the end of the 50s. We are not too far for Second World War, and my wish was to be a pilot. And I prepared myself to be a pilot of the Brazilian Air Force. And I went for the first time to Rio de Janeiro to do a kind of concourse, to see if I was accepted to be what kind of a younger guy in the army to learn to be a pilot. And I came with a long trip, because we had no roads in that time. We had a train, went to a town. From there, we get a bus that we spend about 40 hours in bus to arrive in Rio. And I made my test, and it was necessary to wait 1 week. The wish to see my mother was so big that I don't know if it was approved or not. I went back. And when I came to the farm, I came to the gate of the farm, and my mother saw me off about 800 meters high. She came and got me in the arm. It was one of the greatest moments in my life that said, my Christ, I have a mother. No? Because having a mother, you never see that you have a mother. On the day that you need your mother, that you discover that I have an incredible person in your life, that was my mother. Another great day is when I met Lelia, my wife, that apologize, she's not here today. We are there this week, and she's doing a cultural tour in London today, showing shows and the scene. But when I met Lelia, it was 1964. You see, it's incredible when you met a person that 1 month later you have a joint bank account, when just starting my life. And it was forever. Now, it was so amazing, so fantastic. And I had the opportunity with Lelia to be inside photography. It was about, we were starting, and I was living in a small hotel, because my parents live inside a farm in Ontario. I was living in a small hotel. And one of the guys said, Sebastian, I invite you to come to the photo club of our town. I said, fabulous. Gave appointment Saturday, 10 in the morning. Saturday, 10 in the morning, I was there with Len. And the guy forget to come. We wait 2 hours in the door. Said, no way. And was probably the first opportunity that I had to be a photographer. Till now, that month, I never had made a photography in my life. And after I went, I made my studies, I became an economist. We put ourselves inside the leftist movement in Brazil, fight against dictatorship. We came to Europe, I became an economist. I were an economist. I became to do a PhD in the University of Paris. And there, I came to photography again. It's when Lelia bought a camera in 1970 to do pictures of architecture. When I saw for the first time through a viewfinder, was a picture of her, of course, sitting in a window. I made this picture of Lelia, and was from this moment, everything changed in my life. I started to be possible to materialize things that all my life I discovered that were marvelous, incredible, and was supposed to have there in a way. This was fantastic for me. We came to live in England because I was working here in an international coffee organization. And here we start in a month to visit one new gallery that was open here called Photographers Gallery. That started in that moment. We started to go. We knew a lady called Sue Davis that was incredible lady. And we started to see photography. And I started to see books of photography. And we started to, photography came inside my life. I did missions in Africa because we are working in a big investment center here. We had a huge fund of investment. We made missions in Africa with the World Bank to finance projects to do the diversification of coffee plantation. But when we came back to London, the pictures that they made there made 10 times more pleasure than the economic report that was necessary to write. And I remember with Lelia, we get a small boat, went inside Serpentine Lake here near Hyde Park, stopped this boat middle there, and for hours discussing. We go to Washington to work in the World Bank, had a proposition to be young economist in the World Bank, or we stop this everything and become a photographer. In a month of photography, take over. And I went back, I resigned from my job, I went back to Paris and started my photograph life.
Back in Brazil and even in Paris, you've described yourself as a Marxist at that time.
What did?
You were a Marxist at that time in Brazil and back
no,
in Paris.
No, we were forbidden to go to Brazil. We were fighting against dictatorship. In a month, here I had passport yet when I was in England, but when we came back to France after London, we started to act inside a big movement to receive Brazilians that come outside of the torture in Brazil.
Yeah.
They can completely destroy it. And in this moment, the Brazilian government took out our passport.
Yeah.
and no way to go back.
One of the reasons you fled was you were almost arrested.
Yeah.
Because you were of the left and you were protesting the dictators. And this is correct, yes?
What did
you? You were protesting against the dictators.
You were of the left. Of course, I hear very bad.
So between us will be great. I'm interested in a dilemma, because, you know, there's all this mythology about you, that you were this leftist photographer, and that makes complete sense. And then you've described this dilemma on the boat, on the Serpentine, yes, where there's you and Lelia, and you're wondering for 4 hours, do you go and become a crusading photographer, or do you go and work for the World Bank?
Okay. Were you really going to join the World Bank, which was then, you know, the president of it was then McNamara, the guy who just tried to annihilate all the communists in Vietnam, and they were doing all these massive infrastructure projects destroying Brazil at that time. Were you really thinking, I'm going to join the World Bank? Was this really a possibility?
You see, I've seen many things, many positions that you take, the radical position, and sometimes there is no place for radicalism. The World Bank is not a political institution. McNamara was a guy from the front line of the American government, but he was president of an institution where the United States has the most amount of money on it. But you have participation of all countries around the world on these things. And the amount of projects that the World Bank financed was not political projects, were economical projects, and sometimes was very important for the development of a lot of different countries. For example, when I was in London, we went to Rwanda. We invest in a project for the diversification of coffee plantation. We had an agreement in coffee in the world in order to maintain the price of the coffee. And that was very nice for the country that produced coffee and for the guys working in coffee around the world. And we were equilibrating this offer and this demand. When we came to Rwanda, what we did? We identified lands that's adapted for coffee, yeah. But if you have planted tea in place, we will not use this land for coffee. And we financed a project there, the first project I made, all the analysis of the economic return of the project, we employed 34,000 families, or more than 100,000 people, that went to produce tea, and they produced good tea, that produced a nice way of life. As the country had not enough money to pay this project, International Coffee Organization put 10% of the project.
Okay.
And World Bank put 9% of the project. I was not involved with World Bank, but the International Coffee Organization. But this had nothing to do with politics. It was something to do with stabilization of a price of a product. But you see, I'm a person from the left. I'm not a leftist photographer, because photography is much more than just politics. No, photography is a way of life. I photograph with my life, with my beliefs, with my ethics, anything that was inside myself. But I'm not a radical in the sense that the World Bank is the extreme right of the United States. It's not true. World Bank is an institution. The United States is a country with an incredible imperialist position, military position that I am against, but World Bank is another thing. Is another. You ask the monetary fund. Monetary fund has nothing to do with politics. We have a participation of all countries around the world. Is a tentative to equilibrate the flow of the money around the world. You see, we made an option in this one. In fact, we made all together, same people that is against, participate in this option. We live in a free market economy. We try, I am a word from the left. The left tests that maybe not work in Soviet Union. This does not work. And what part of this world? And these tools are part of the society that were part of it. And I'm for social justice and fight best that I can for that. I'm for an equilibrium environment that don't destroy the environment. But we are part of a system.
Can you tell us about your early work? Bringing back to your photography. because I feel I've taken us, by mentioning the World Bank, I've taken us in some sort of economics track that I suspect is not the desire for this room to hear a whole lot of economics. I don't know. But back on, tell me more if you want a lot of economics. Talk us through those first few series.
In here, I was never an activist photographer. I was never a photojournalist. I was never an economist photographer. Photography is my life. It's what I believe in. It's what my heritage brings me to this. When I do photography, I'm doing something with my soul, with my beliefs, with my ethics. And of course, that me, I came from a third world country, underdeveloped country. Today is a developing country, but was an underdeveloped country for all my life long. And when I started to do photography, I tried in the beginning to do nude, I tried to do landscape, I tried to do many different things. One day, I discovered that it was 100% full inside social photography. It's normal from where I come from. The studies that I made, the activism and politics that I had when I was in the university and all my life long, will bring me in that direction. That was the work that I did. After a month, the things were so bad with migration, what I saw that was a disaster that I saw in all of this world, that I lose the faith in the human species, and I stopped the photography. We developed this environmental project in Brazil, and when I came back to photography with Genesis, I came inside a photography very close to the environment. But all this is part of my life. It's because I trust on him. I believe you cannot be in the role of photographing for 8 years if it's not your project. Because 8 years is 10% of a life of someone if you live 8 years, or is 40% of a life of photographer because you don't photograph all of life. You have 30 years of life. You see, you must have a huge identification with these things. And photography was much more than anything. Photography is my way.
Will you show us a little bit of the Genesis project?
Guys, I bring here 2 DVDs. It was a big discussion with Leo. I show a DVD with my picture before Genesis, and stop in Genesis, where I show Genesis picture. And finally take decision, probably to show Genesis. And if you agree, we show Genesis, but if by chance you prefer that we show the pictures before Genesis, I cannot show the 2 because we have a limit of time. After, we have a conference that's going on.
Shall we put a vote to the room?
What do you prefer?
Genesis? Who wants pre-Genesis or Genesis? Pre-Genesis, first of all.
Pre-Genesis.
Whoa.
Who wants Genesis? Who wants Genesis?
Okay, we do pre-Genesis.
All right, let's wait. All right, good.
Okay, afterwards, will you help me try and persuade them to let us see a bit of Genesis?
Okay. These pictures that will be showing, I made a kind of sequence on them. I put all the horizontal pictures. I take all the verticals because we be melting one inside the other. We put a very nice music of Gorecki. That is, Gorecki is probably most of people here know, is one contemporary composer from Holland, and that is the 3rd symphony of Gorecki that I put inside this music. The music that I put in this project is the music normal that I use to edit my pictures. And I believe that's the kind of music that adapts quite well to this kind of picture. This sequence that we see, we start with a few pictures that I took in Latin America that became a book called Other Americas. That aperture just launched the book. Again, now it's a book, first book that was 30 years ago when we did, and that came from a series that I did in Africa, and when I started photographies in Africa, and with workers, with migration. Africa was part of the job that I did with Médecins Sans Frontières, Save the Children Fund here in England, and a series of humanitarian institutions in the world. And even we finish with the series of migration, the series of migration. The one that I stopped to photograph, what I feel there was so dramatic, so hard, that we can speak about after, before, to discuss a little bit about what I did after this, that was changed, okay? We go ahead and you see, and after, I believe that's better to...
We can turn it open to the room.
To put questions and go to the limit of time that we have. It's okay?
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. talking to us. I'm actually very interested to hear you talk about economics, as your work so obviously represents economics on a world scale, on a local scale. And as Marxism was mentioned, as free market was mentioned, I would just like to know what you think is a possible alternative to the economic system that we have today, having witnessed and having given us testimony of how economics affects the life of people, exploitation of resources, control, and somewhat linked to that.
Whoa, that's enough. Hold on, let's let me deal with that one first of all.
No, you see, very complicated. Because it's a question for a philosopher, no? To reply, is an option of society that we may probably start in this country, no? We come inside of the first big industrial revolution, and we create an incredible movement organization on this planet, and that is the model that we choose. For every country, my country, when I was a child, we had 90% or a little bit more, 92% of Brazilian population that lives in the fields. What we made in 400 years to urbanize, we made in 40 years. Brazil today has more than 92% of the urban population. China is about the same today. India will be more than 50% today of the world. The Indian population is living in towns. And for this, it's necessary to feed them. It's necessary to deal with all the problems that create all this urban population. It's necessary to transform the agriculture. That was, I remember when I was a child, you knew the name of each cow, each animal. You are part of them, you live together. It was something that you are part of you. And all these become a commodity today. I remember the day here in the United States about 5-10 years ago, we had mouth and foot disease that happened in the cattle here. And the army went inside this farm here and shot them, all the cows, and so the peasants crying because it's just a commodity. It's like you have no more relation. It's the model of all the planet. How can we strike back? How can we live in another way? Today you are the big problem that we're raising there, big conflict. That you are having a so huge emission of the oxide of carbon that you are heating too fast our planet. And you are going to have huge problems. And the big problem that we don't find a solution. Each time we had the first meeting in Rio de Janeiro, speaking about ecology, 20 years later, we have Rio 20 years later. And the problems each time are bigger, each time more complicated. And I don't know. What will be the solution? We must find a solution. We must get away. No, the model. A friend of mine tells that you are about to build 200 huge buildings here in London, new buildings here in this town. You see the consumption of energy in one of these buildings is much bigger than the medium-sized town inside England. One.
Sebastian, you've said that you think we've become stupider since we moved to cities.
No, I don't believe that we can remove the cities.
No, but you've stopped. We've become stupider since we have moved.
No.
And I know you're going to...
But there's a movement that started before this. No, we came in, and we became a species that we are too much in the planet. Before, when I was a child, 60 years old, 70, we would die. And organized in a way that now we can go beyond 90 years, 100 years, and we are doing this in Africa, doing this everywhere. And everything that we do today in our society must have an integrity, must have an economic return. We don't speak more in social investment. And you see, we must question everything that we are living. We choose together, but if you don't choose together, don't participate, we have no alternative. And that's the big point. We become more just consumers. I had here, in this house, about 5 years ago, a quite large show about Amazonia. And I remember that was November, October, November, we came here, was the day before Halloween. And when to the streets here around, we have all these stores selling the Halloween goods, one back to the other. And the other day of Halloween, we had all this stuff in the garbage. No,
what we burn as resources to produce bushing, that don't mean nothing, pan means nothing. And how many energy, that is the problem. You see, it's a problem of society. What is the solution? I don't know, but we must have one if the control will be complicated.
But is part of it to return the equilibrium with nature, which is part of your project?
Well, necessarily, because you see, we are planting trees in Brazil. We have environmental project to start with land, and today one of the biggest environmental projects in Brazil. We plant more than 2 million trees down there in the farm that was the farm of my parents. That was an incredible rainforest when we had fire. When you received this farm, it was all completely destroyed. My father destroyed everything. But the neighborhood of my father destroyed also everyone destroyed. To build this society, that our incredible society that we live in this town, we live back to as a desert. And that is the big point, you know. And we have an incredible emission of carbon. We have, in my country, no more water. In California, no more water. In India, no more water. Because the only machine capable to create water, the only machine that is the same, capable to transform the CO2 form, that is the carbon form, one molecule of carbon and two of oxygen, are the trees. The trees by the photosynthesis, the trees by the retention of the humidity, they can hold the source of water. And we keep killing them non-stop, non-stop. And the trees that we plant means nothing. I went to Scotland the other day. Scotland is full of trees, but it's a lie, it's not the trees. This is monoculture of, it's agriculture of trees. These trees are there to be cut, to become furniture, to become fuel, and the carbon that sequestrated to grow. They give them back again when they are cut. That means nothing. We must have native forest, the forest that will stay there. And we can do what we are doing in Brazil. I'm not rich. My wife, Lely, is not rich. We raise money, we organize, we put together, we plant all these trees, and we are about to start a project that in the next year will be plant more than 100 million trees. We will do, we will save our water system, our watershed around us. What's possible to do this everywhere? If you do this, it would be possible to liberate our life. But there is no one diamond road there because this is not an investment that gives economic return. There is no rentability. This is social investment. But in our society, in a moment, we must take a decision to do social investment because it's the way that we must live. The country will be complicated. You see, this decision must be taken. A lot of people is fighting for, a lot of environmental institutions in the country is fighting for, all over the world. But for the moment, you are yet minority. One day, this must become the majority.
Religious influence and imagery, I feel it's a very strong biblical aspect to your photographs.
Is there a religious influence? The lady in the green shirt feels there is a strong biblical theme in your imagery.
I'm not a believer. I believe in peanuts. No. If I believe in someone was Darwin, that the guy that made the real analysis of our evolution that arrived at the point, you know, to understand what animal we are. But of course, that from where I come from, I'm born in the state of Minas Gerais in Brazil that Leo knows very well. And I come from the most baroque place of the planet. All the Portuguese baroque are born down there. In the lights of Minas Gerais, when I was a kid in the farm of my father took my hand, I was too small, we walked 8-10 kilometers to arrive in a point to wait the rains that would become in the afternoon and to see these amazing clouds with all this light cross through, arriving the rain, was the starting of the rain season to see. And of course, these lights stay inside me. When I go to the world, it's my lights. I'm looking for them. And all these came inside, no? But religion, I have no religion.
Can I pick you up on that? Because I also feel you have seven sisters called Maria. there's something of the sublime. Okay, you yourself say that you don't take these pictures. The pictures are given to you. And you get them through some extraordinary connectedness with your subject, where you are appreciating in that subject something that is extraordinary, something that's almost divine in those people and places around you. Is that not the case?
You see, we are a gregarian animal. You see, look, our history has how many? 6,000 years old. Yes, Egyptian story. But our history is become to be history, the moment that we become to tell the history of the communities. And that is the point. We live here in London, in addition of communities by air and by door, we are an animal made to live together. And when you go, I go photograph, I went alone for all this place, but arriving at a place, you are assimilated, you are a saint. You become part of a way of life of others. And this way of life of others become your home. You are there. And from the moment you are integrated with these places, you need that time to photograph. Photography is not to be sent for a magazine in a place, take a few smart shots and bring them back. As I said before, photography is a way of life. The moment of photography is very long. The fraction of second that you freeze it is very fast. But to arrive there, you must live the phenomenon, you must be part of it in order to get it. Everything will be happening in front of you. It's a question of time, it's a question of patience, it's a question of dedication of your life for it. And that is the point in photography. When I said a few minutes ago that I'm not a photojournalist, that I'm not an activist, it's not this, it's a way of life, it's my life. When I went to see this guy that you saw in the picture in Latin America, I spent 5-6 years with this guy. And yesterday we are projecting a film, what I say something that I never said before. That is, going there, I had no money to go and come every 2 weeks. It was necessary to spend 3 months, 4 months with people. And my wife was the most pretty lady that you can imagine. You know? My son, that was filmmaker that made this film with Wim Wenders, Julian was 2-3 years old, and my wife was alone with my son, and me, I was alone in this mountain. In the afternoons, in Sundays, I went alone from a place that was crying. I wished to see my family to there, and these pictures have a price. It's a price of a life that were there, that were integrated, that were participating. And it's this the point. You see, when you see a festival like this, of photography, you can go there now, going out of it, and look the picture that we interest you. It's the picture that have on history. There is a lot of smart photographers here that made smart pictures to be here to be saved. You see, the picture that the guy put his imagination into, but these are not the pictures that really touch someone. The picture that touch someone is pictures that are the history of all of us together that are there. No? Picture of this photographer that dedicated their life to do this picture. This is the real photography for me.
So, your photographs are an inspiring example of what photography can be. In the last 10 years, we've seen photography become a very banal thing in our lives with digital and phones and so on. How do you feel when you see that?
You see, majority of photography is gone. It's finished. Very few people does photography today. You see, when your father, your mother made pictures of you, went to the corner of your street, gave your film to develop, made the picture, the print, made in the album, you talk to this album. This is how we're there, this picture turned a little bit, break. Was something tangible that we saw was a picture. You come back, it's a memory, it's your history. Photography today is no more photography, it's an image. It's a concept. This is inside a telephone. This is inside a computer. It's not more tangible. It's something that you transfer, that one day you lose your telephone, you lose all this together. No, but you do more and more, but I will not criticize. It's another moment of the capture of the image. But this moment where photography was photography is gone. Only photographers, as me, as others, that do, that print, that take the picture, do photography yet. Now we are doing image that we can change them, that we made them more, change the backs, put other things. You see, my son and the inventor did this film about me. The cameras that they use is the same camera that they use to photograph. It's a camera that before was only for photography, now it's for cinema and photography. No, and more for scene than photography. And we are in a transition. We are going for another stage with the names. And many of the photographies that we see here is the past. It's something that become a reference for the historical moment that we live. But it started to be another thing, photography. Very few people go for months, for years, to do some trip where photography is the language, is a cross section that will bring the memory of the trips. This is speech.
Have you ever taken a selfie?
I never made out a portrait of myself.
How much do you need to be paid by someone in the room to do a selfie?
No, today we did at least 50 selfies of others come with me doing this. And this is so new, the self-portrait. You see, when I started Genesis 2 years ago here, the Natural History Museum in London, no one person came there to take a selfie. Self came with the Instagram, with these new things that's come. Everyone needed to do this picture to put it there. It's a communication, it's a language, I agree, no problem. But when you come for a place like yesterday evening, when I project the field, what I do, I go because the guys, you must pose for all this. After the number 20 or number 50, you have no more energy. You want to join that. No? And that's the problem with that. But it's very recent. So I think they started 1 year, 1.5 years ago, they now become the face. We have the impression that we did that forever, for the life. That's not the truth. Me, I'm a photographer that worked more than 40 years. I never make one self-portrait of myself.
I suggest we take like 3 questions at a time, and you can try to do what you can with them. Got a question at the back there, one here.
But who wants to make the resume?
And then one here, which I got to confess, public discussion is from my wife, and I'll be in trouble if I don't ask this question. Okay, so one, and then we'll do next. Okay, sorry. So if you, please. Make it short.
An aesthetic question. Sorry, it's very superficial. But your print style is very heavy. There's always strong contrast, big blacks, heavy skies. What should we learn from that?
Okay. Print style, technical question, heavy contrast, monochrome.
For someone who really likes your style of photography, like how do you actually start off? Like, do you like find an organization and then work now, or do you just find your own projects?
For someone starting out in photography?
Yeah, and interested in this.
How would you start out now if you were starting out in photography?
Right.
Most if not all of the pictures are of the developing world. If you say that photography is a way of life, and you live in Paris, and you've spent a lot of time in Paris, how come you never moved to take any pictures of the developed world?
Why don't you take pictures of the developed world as well?
Let's start from the end. There is a lot of guys that take pictures of the developed world. But I am from the underdeveloped. It's from there that I come from. It's my origin. No? And of course that you are linked with your origin. I take a lot of pictures of this developed world also. Well, I was speaking with Francis here a few minutes ago before that we started here. I work a lot for the developers. And here in this country, I did big campaigns of a Volvo. You cannot be wrong with your Volvo here in England. I take a lot of these pictures to survive. I work for a secret cutter cigarette here, you know. I take a lot of pictures here also. But my real work, lot of work. It's from where I come from. To tell for a young photographer, a guy that's starting today, I can tell only my kind of photography. If you see a young photographer that see that he's really one photographer, want to do photography, if he has opportunity, you stop the photography a while, go to the university, study a little bit of anthropology, of sociology, of economy, of geopolitics, in order to understand the society that you live. To be part of them. Like this, you can link your work with the historical movement that you are living, your pictures, as a sense.
Can I just add in one more? Like, I actually studied economics, and that's why I really connect to your transition from economics to photography.
Good. You have an economist. No, you see, it's so important to have a wide preparation. We prepare a lot of technicians in our university. They are mono eye, they see only one direction. It's very important to see why. That's it, is the important point. And what do we have the first question?
Your use of technique.
I use any technique. I tell you, when I have my show here in Natural History Museum, I have a few people that made some creeds that, oh, Sebastian work a lot of a kind of fucker. That made a kind of, these textures, these things. That's not true at all. I work all my life long with just one film. That was the first film that was not necessary to use track called Traix. That I pushed this film most high sensitive that I was possible when it was necessary. And like this was possible to do my life, to go in that direction. And the contrasts. You see, when we have a writer that writes a book, he has a style, he writes in a certain way. A photographer has his own way to write with his photography. And mine is more or less like this, but I must tell you, our language in photography is a complete aesthetical language, because we work with a frame, with a form, it's a formal language. And we work with light, with shadows, with plans, with lines, and that made a writer, a way to write. And each one has his own style. If we have 100 photographers here in this room, we have 100 different styles. And mine is this. People like or don't like, but it's this.
Okay, another round. Lady in the Orange, right in front of me, okay. Denim, very nice denim shirt.
Thanks.
At the back, with the beard.
You want a beard?
Okay. documentary photography. We are in a period of time where people take lots of photographs, millions of photographs. But at the same time, magazine, media don't give any more much space for traditional photography. They are cutting budget for it. What's your point of view on this? I mean, in the sense we have this huge photography festival.
Okay. Yeah. Great, hold on. And then we get the head.
Do you get do you select your final photograph easily or in a frame or two, or do you go through many frames before you make a selection?
Do you find the photograph you want very easily? Or do you rummage through the frames and choose with great difficulty?
I didn't understand the question.
How hard is it for you to choose the specific image that you want from the series?
After that, I do.
You were already a social photographer when you had your young child who's likely disabled. How did you find that bringing in your life changed you as a person and as a photographer?
How did your own son's Down syndrome change you as a photographer, as a social photographer?
Well, I'm just interested
in... I'm not four, not three.
Yeah, but you were so good last time.
You speak very highly of your wife, and she seems to be a big support system to you. When I saw the documentary that Momenda did on you, I wanted to know more about her, because she seems so important to you, but she was not mentioned as much as I would have liked to. Would you say that your images... without her, if they wouldn't have been possible?
Out of her, out of my Down syndrome, son would be another thing. It's not that we would not be possible, it'd be another completely different thing. You see, my wife, I met her, she was 16 years old. Me, I was about 19, 20 years when we met. You see, we made all these studies together. We traveled all our life, we made anything together. I don't know where I feel with my wife. Starts and we did. My wife is not. I hear a lot of people said, "Oh, back to a important man or something." There is a wife, and my wife said always correct. Back not beside, because she was always beside. We conceive any of this project. It's necessary to have a conception of all this together. We imagine everything. The presentation, all my shows. She's the great. She designed the book. She's so smart. She has a fabulous taste. And plus, the movies I love, we have an incredible life with our Down syndrome kid, the one came. No one is prepared to have a suffering Down syndrome kid. And this kid made a huge charging our life in a point that, for example, with a Down syndrome kid, you have someone that don't communicate too much with you. But we never put our child in any institution. He was always with us. On every day he goes to institution, come back to home. And like that made you not have a social life, because we stay with him. And no one is prepared to accept your son Down syndrome. Only the guys that have the same problem, that means you create another life. And you built a life in a sense that's only yours. There is a problem in photography. I believe in other creative language. Is that in our society we love the lonesome cowboys, the heroes. And when they see a photographer, they speak about me, Sebastião Salgado. They don't speak about all people that's with me to work. I have a group of people that work together. I have three printers that do the sprints. I have two girls that work with us more than 30 years that we do together. We are a rock. We made all together just the upper part of the iceberg. The other, we don't see. An example, the film that we saw. Every people say, oh, the film of Wim Wenders. No, the film was Juliano, our son, that started the film, and Wim came out. But as Wim is the person that's the big name, we go to the big name. Is that a kind of vicious that we have in our society? You see, and the other question, how I choose the pictures, is the same that we are speaking. I do not choose alone my pictures. I photograph, I come back, I do the contact sheet, same now that I'm doing a digital picture. I cannot edit in a computer. I don't know how to go and look a picture in a computer. They made my contact sheets from my shooting in digital, and I go to a new. I use myself, I do the first editing. I prepare a lot of work prints. I have at least 500,000 prints in my student files. All my work prints are there. And I go through the work prints, and this month I don't go alone. I go with Françoise, that is a girl that we do this after 30 years. We work together in Magnum for 15 years. She finished in Magnum in 1994, 20 years ago, she came to work with me, and we do together. After that, we do this first cut in the work prints. We have yet a big amount of work. It's not a letter that my wife can. And we three, we work. Because in pictures, sometimes you have a huge identification with a picture, but it speaks mean nothing for us. And you put a so emotive charge on it that we show for other things, not me. And I have these two persons that we made the things that we conceived together that aid to equilibrate. In the end, we finish with a set of pictures, that's our reference picture. Reference set, that what we have. Genesis, for example, we finish with about 5,000 prints that we like very much, but we will never show them, because we can show maximum 200 times. And when you do a book, you put 300, but no more than this. I give you an example. I had an agreement with Guardian in the beginning of Genesis that we went for a few years together. In a month, they changed the perception of the British for what was interesting for them was not more images of outside England, what inside England, for the young movements inside England. In this moment they came out of the James project, they did other thing. And like this, we evolved to each other, and today the magazines do special pictures, the pictures have no more value. But there is another thing that came, is the social institutions, is the what we call third sector, is the charity institution, is the environmental institution, that they are using incredible amount of pictures, that there is a new development for photographers there. You see, it's an adaptation, it's evolution as the cameras change, the way to use the pictures change, and the thing is like this. When I was in Magnum, I was sending around the planet to do stories where I was supposed to stay 2-3 months in a story. Today, that's finished. You had a string of photographers that is down there in Iraq that made the pictures. In 1 minute or late, the pictures inside the magazine to print that cost peanuts for them, that cost before was necessary to explain. Is this point. But there is a way, because there is a lot of young photographers that are working and working well.
Sebastian, I'm getting signals that we got it clear. I want one last question, which is not a small one, it's at the level of the one about what is the future of the world economy, which is you said you lost your faith in humanity. You went down into what Juliana and the inventors referred to as your heart of darkness. Have you started to regain it?
Yes. Now today I have a big hope. I don't believe I believe that we can rebuild this planet. I believe in a lot of things. But you see, when I finished my duration, I was really deeply pessimist. I was 100% sure that the human species was going against a wall that was a programmed species to finish. And I stopped photography for a moment. We went back to Brazil to become farmers, received this farm of my parents. This land was so destroyed that was not possible to do nothing in this land. Then he planted the forest there. We take the decision to transform this land in a national park, and we started to plant the forest. And with the coming back of the trees, the water, the insects, the mammals, everything came back. I gave a huge enthusiasm to life, and we conceived this Genesis project that went for 8 years. And what I learned in Genesis, what I saw in the planet, today I have a big optimism for the planet.
For nature and for mankind as well?
Mankind is different. I only mind my species. When I photograph only social photography, only human. Today I come back from photograph hundreds of different alive species, vegetal, mineral, animal, and today for me these species of ants are as important as human species. These species of termites are as important as our species. These species of waves are as important of our species. And if we finish, it's not a damage for the planet. The planet rebuilt himself in 100 years. The planet is like it was 5 million years before. The planet has a capacity of rebuilding. Incredible. And today, I'm optimistic for the planet, but if you don't pay attention, don't take care, we go 100% against the wall. And that means, for the humans, I don't see yet how we can come. We are fine, I'm fine together. I'm inside this human species, my species, and we are trying the best that we can to see, but this is a problem that we must do together. Or we do together, or we die together. Together means we all, our institutions, our enterprises, our governments, we together. We sit in a tower and put the finger, the companies that are polluting. Okay, the steel plants are polluting, but who one here do not have a car? Who one here do not have a pen, do have a computer, do have a tripod, do have a camera? We needed the metal to be there, we needed the miners, we needed the steel plants, we needed the oil companies, because it's the option that we made. The discussion is to see, to put in question our options, the society that we have, in order to build another thing. Or we do together, or we will die together. That's the simple question.
On that note,